Hey guys, welcome back to this new video. In this part of the series, I will talk about how services communicate between them, or what we technically call inter-process communication. This first introductory video will be an overview. In a monolithic application, the different components invoke one another via language level methods or through function calls. Everything is done inside the monolith in the same machine. In contrast, a microservices application is a distributed system running on multiple machines. Then each service instance is typically seen as a separate process. This is why we are saying that services must interact using an inter-process communication mechanism, or what we are calling by brevity IPC. The inter-process communication includes many other concerns, such as the different possible communication styles. The service discovery, or how can a service knows the IP addresses of the other services. The reliability of communication, or how can we communicate with a reliable manner even though some services can be unavailable. And the transactional messaging, which concern the ways of communication when implementing some database transactions. All these concerns will be dealt with in the next videos, but right now, we will focus on the different communication styles in addition to some complementary information. The promise of this lecture is helping you be able to determine how services interact, specify the appropriate message format, and define and manage the evolution of a services API. If you are interested in this, let's jump into the presentation agenda. As stated before, I will focus in this presentation on giving an overview of IPC mechanisms in a microservice architecture. I will begin with showing how services can interact. Then I will talk about the possible message formats exchanged when two or more services communicate. After that, I will show how to specify an API for a service, in addition to how to manage these APIs when they evolve over time. When selecting an IPC mechanism for a service, it is useful to think first about how services interact. All the possible interaction styles can be categorized along two dimensions. The first dimension emphasizes the number of services involved in this interaction. We talk then about two possibilities, one-to-one or one-to-many interaction. The second dimension focuses more on the nature of the interaction, if it is synchronous or asynchronous. The one-to-one type of interaction is provided when a client request is processed by exactly one service instance, which means that one service communicates with one and only one service. The one-to-many type of interaction occurs when a request is processed by multiple services instances, and we are talking here about communication that concerns one service with other services. Concerning the second dimension, the synchronous communication is a way of communicating when the client or the request sender expects a timely response from the service and might even block while it is waiting. In contrast, the asynchronous communication is done when the client doesn't block while waiting for a response, and this response, if any, isn't necessarily sent immediately. Now that we have an idea on the two dimensions we will rely on, I will focus first on the one-to-one interactions. One-to-one and synchronous interaction is the well-known request response. In this style of interaction, the client makes a request to a service and waits for a response. The client expects the response to arrive in a timely fashion. In a thread-based application, the thread that makes the request may even block while waiting. Concerning the asynchronous communication, the first option is the notification, also known as the one-way request. The client sends a request to a service, but no reply is expected or sent. The second asynchronous option is the request asynchronous responses, when a client sends a request to a service, which replies asynchronously. The client does not block while waiting and is designed with the assumption that the response may not arrive for a while. Concerning the one-to-many interactions, there is no existing possible interaction when the communication is synchronous. However, when it is asynchronous, we can consider the publish-subscribe interaction when a client publishes a notification message which is consumed by zero or more interested services. The publish-async responses is another asynchronous interaction that takes action when a client publishes a request message and then waits a certain amount of time for responses from interested services. In real-world cases, there are a lot of scenarios when a service uses a combination of these interaction styles. For example, let's consider how services interact in an Uber-like application when the user requests a trip. The passenger's smartphone sends a notification to the trip management service to request a pickup. The trip management service verifies that the passenger account is active by using request response to invoke the passenger management service. After that, the trip management service sends a notification message to a dispatcher telling him that the trip was created. The dispatcher will then publish that a driver is proposed for that trip to the passenger management service in addition to the driver management service. Both services will use a notification service to notify the passenger. Whatever the used interaction style, each of the exchange messages between services has a specific format. Messages usually contain data, and so an important design decision is the format of that data. The choice of the message format can impact the efficiency of the IPC, the usability of the API, and its evolvability. So, what are the possible message formats? This is the question that I will answer in this part. The first thing to consider is using a cross-language message format. Even if you are writing your microservices in a single language today, it's likely that you will use other languages in the future. Basically, there are two main categories of message formats: text and binary. The first category is text-based formats such as JSON and XML. An advantage of these formats is that they are not only human-readable, but they are also self-describing. A downside of using a text-based messages format is that the messages tend to be verbose, especially XML. Another drawback is the overhead of parsing text, especially when messages are large. Consequently, if efficiency and performance are important, you may want to consider using a binary format. There are several different binary formats to choose from. Popular formats include protocol buffers, Thrift, and Evro. All these formats provide a typed interface definition language for defining the structure of the messages, and the compiler then generates the code that serializes and deserializes these messages. If you need more details about all these formats and technologies, you can check some useful links I put in the description. After having an idea on the different interaction styles and the possible message formats, it is time to see how to specify a service's API. APIs are central to software development, and a well-designed API exposes the useful functionalities while hiding the implementation, which enables the implementation to change without impacting the clients. Services API is a contract between the service and its clients. It consists of operations which clients can invoke and events which are published by the service. An operation has a name, parameters, and a return type. And an event has a type and a set of fields and is published to a message channel. The challenge is that a service and its clients aren't compiled together. Hence, the obligation to use an IPC mechanism that guarantees the interoperability of the two services. Regardless of which IPC mechanism you choose, it is important to precisely define a service's API using some kind of interface definition language. Also, there are many good reasons for using an API-first approach to define services. You begin the development of a service by writing the interface definition and reviewing it with the client developers. Only after iterating on the API definition, you can then implement the service. Doing this upfront design increases your chance of building a service that meets the needs of its clients. On the other hand, the nature of the API definition depends on which IPC mechanism you are using. For example, if you are using messaging, the API consists of the message channels, the message types, and the message formats. If you are using HTTP, the API consists of the URLs, the HTTP verbs, and the request and response formats. A service's API is rarely set in stone. It will likely evolve over time. So let's take a look at how to do that and consider the issues we will face. APIs invariably change over time as new features are added, existing features are changed, and perhaps old features are removed. In a monolithic application, it is relatively straightforward to change an API and update all the colors. In a microservice-based application, changing a service's API is a lot more difficult. A service's clients are other services which are often developed by other teams. The clients may even be other applications outside of the organization, and you usually can't force all clients to upgrade in lockstep with the service. Also, because modern applications are usually never down for maintenance, you will typically perform a rolling upgrade of your service, so both the old and the new versions of a service will be running simultaneously. In all cases, it is important to have a strategy for dealing with these challenges. How to handle an API change depends on the size of the change. In fact, the semantic versioning specification is a useful guide for versioning APIs. It is a set of rules that specify how version numbers are used and incremented. It was originally intended to be used for versioning software packages, but you can use it for versioning APIs in a distributed system. The semantic versioning specification distinguishes between minor changes when some backward compatible enhancements to the API are made, and on the other hand, major changes when a non-compatible change to the API is made. Backward compatible changes are generally additive changes to an API. For instance, adding optional attributes to a request, or adding attributes to a response, or adding new operation, and so on. If you make these kinds of changes, older clients and newer services must use a request and response format that supports the robustness principle. This principle states that you have to be conservative in what you do and be liberal in what you accept from others. For example, services should provide default values for missing request attributes. And similarly, clients should ignore any extra response attributes. Sometimes you must make major and incompatible changes to an API. Because you can't force clients to upgrade immediately, a service must simultaneously support all the new versions of an API for some period of time. If you are using an HTTP call, for example, an HTTP-based IPC mechanism, such as REST, one approach is to embed the major version number in the URL. For example, version 1 paths are prefixed with V1 and version 2 paths with V2. Another solution to support multiple versions of an API is to well configure the services adapters that implement the APIs. They will contain some logic to translate between the old and the new versions. To sum up, here are some key takeaways to consider concerning the inter-process communication aspect in microservices. The microservice architecture is a distributed architecture, so inter-process communication plays a key role. All the possible interaction styles between services can be categorized along two dimensions: one-to-one and one-to-many interactions in one side, and synchronous and asynchronous communication style in the other. The resulting interaction styles are then the request response, notifications, request asynchronous responses, publish subscribe, and publish asynchronous responses. It is important to consider a cross-language message format between two choices, which are the text format or binary format. And it is essential to carefully define and manage the evolution of services API. That's it. Let me know in the comments section if you have any questions, and don't forget to like the video and subscribe to the channel. See you in the next video.